So, this is another. This is going to be a free-flowing discussion, free-flowing meaning only that there's no overarching agenda to get through. This is more. Still in effort to get some things recorded that have been hanging around in my mind for a while. Where we're going to start with here, some commentary on Panzer Grenadier series. This was, or what I'm going to start off talking about in particular, the map and the counter and graphics, was prompted. These remarks are prompted by looking at some of the pictures of newer games, looking at the maps for, is it Beyond the Rhine? So there are definitely some personal comments I would like to lay out about Panzer Grenadier, which relates to, I guess, some preferences when it comes to maps and graphics, maps and counter graphics. But also, even before that, make some general comments on the Panzer Grenadier series. Now, I am not reluctant to be critical of the Panzer Grenadier series. On the other hand, Panzer Grenadier and Avalanche Press in particular, there's already no shortage of, I guess, negative commentary and coverage online, so I certainly don't want to pile on in that regard. But really, I'm not reluctant to critique and criticize the series because I own a sizable Panzer Grenadier collection. I have no intention or I have no intention of ever getting rid of it. I play the series from time to time, and there are things that I definitely like about it. That stuff is definitely for another installment, another video. And when I need to remember, when I do a video having to do anything with the play of Panzer Grenadier, I should remember to bring in how I use Panzer Grenadier headquarters, the online community dedicated to the Panzer Grenadier series. So this is Eastern Front. This is the second edition. I don't have the first edition, but I do have the, can't see the title right now, but it was Heroes of the Soviet Union. I do have that original one. What that means is, if I remember correctly, I haven't played Heroes of the Soviet Union yet, but I think that one has the original style mounted boards. I think it does. Otherwise, my collection is made up of the either paper, like poster paper maps, or these ASL style heavy stock maps. Now, all I can say when we get to the map graphics of the Panzer Grenadier system, All I can say is I have trained myself to look beyond the map graphics. Because if I didn't look beyond them, they would be so annoying, so distracting, that it would interfere with enjoyment of the actual gameplay. What I mean by that is this ground pattern to me doesn't look like anything real. Doesn't look like anything real, and it doesn't look like any type of useful map either. The roads, I don't know what that's supposed to be. They just don't look, one, they don't look anything like roads, so they're not like the newer multi-man publishing like TCS titles where it looks like really nice realistic computerized graphics. This just looks like, I don't know what, looks like crap, actually. These built up areas, again, they don't look like real overhead imagery. They don't look like urban areas would be represented on a map, a military map, let alone a civilian map, let alone a driving map. The layout of the terrain is, I still think, doesn't resemble anything in reality. Okay, so I understand it's supposed to be the Soviet step, but it could still look better, because if nothing else, even if you use Google Maps and you zoom into some place in, eastern Belarus or northern Ukraine, it doesn't look like this. So that's that. These map these I'm sorry, these hills, high ground. By the way, I think it's great to have elevation lines with elevation indicators. That I have no problem with that. I like that actually. But to also have jarring colors, these I don't know, amateurish elevation indicators is just hard to explain. Hard to explain. Hard to. And then everything is wrong about these maps. Everything. From the tiniest thing, like the hexagons aren't even true hexagons. They're elongated on one side. That's very small, very small. And actually, it's nothing to be mentioned other than everything is wrong about these maps. These hex ID numbers are too big, too bold, not necessary. Like this, not it's not necessary to present them like this. And try, use these maps and make changes. But it's, I should have said, I can't remember if I said or not already. A ton of digital ink has already been spilled about these maps online, and probably too much. Probably too much. And actually, I'll comment on that before I get to the counters. Which, by the way, as a little preview, I want to say that these, here it is, these counters, to contrast with the maps that I think pretty much everything is wrong with, these unit counters are excellent. I mean, just excellent in so many ways. Excellent in so many ways. Yeah, a little thin, but thin counters actually never... thin counters isn't too much of an issue for me. As long as they're high quality. As long as they're durable. As long as they will stand up over time. Thinness alone, I guess, is not too much of an issue. But these counters just... so much is right about these counters. Okay, so why do we tend to go on and on about things like Panzer Grenadier maps? Additions of rules, player aids. So the map you're looking at, this is a city here defended by some German forces. You got Soviet forces coming on the map from this direction, heading down the ugly looking road there to the city. Why do we go on and on about some things like this? Well, first of all, these were just abstract things. We're talking Parcheesi or Pente, then pieces can be, I mean, those are abstract games. The pieces can be abstract. The pieces don't have to signify very much at all, right? But in a historical war game, where we are to believe that this is a piece of terrain in a real piece of terrain in the Soviet Union, which scenario did I set up here? Not that one. Must be. What was that one? Not that one either. Oh. Okay. I for one really like this. This 96 page scenario book. I know some people have complaints about the scenarios. Something to discuss later, but a scenario book like this, lots of fun. Alright, so this is Podlas attacks. With the Red Army on the offensive in front of Moscow, Stavka ordered its forces to attack all along the line. Just east of Kursk, General P.K. Podlas of 40th Army sent three divisions backed by two tank brigades against the German line. German tank and reverse forces stood in reserve. It is this. So this is Podlas attack. So if I'm supposed to believe that this ground represents some area east of Kursk, 3 January 1942, even setting aside the weather issue, this is not abstract. There's something to be said for how real things are portrayed and real things are represented, unlike an abstract thing. So is this supposed to be evocative? Yeah, it should be evocative. of what it's supposed to represent. It should resemble what it's supposed to be representing, in, I guess, kind of natural or intuitive ways. So, yeah. Now, the counters. like I said, I cannot say enough good things about these counters. I will go into some detail here. So first of all, the correct type font, easy to read font. For me, the correct amount of boldness in the font. Font does not detract from use of the counter. What I really want to point out, though, is Panzer Grenadier gets this, in my opinion, so right. So right. So, on the one hand, you have figures, which are actually quite detailed. So you have detailed figures, you know, what, that's 3/4 overhead view or whatever. And you also have the NATO symbol, unit symbol. And to me, this is so right. And it's actually, it's very applicable at this platoon level. So this represents an infantry platoon, which is actually clearly and correctly marked by NATO military symbology. But also figures, which you might say are just a entertaining device, but I mean, I actually don't look at it like that. I look at it as when this platoon is on the ground here. These are 200-meter hexes. Unfortunately, they're not true hexes. But when this platoon, we're talking platoon meaning from anywhere from 25 to 45 soldiers, when this platoon is on this piece of ground, and I were in a helicopter hovering overhead, if I were able to be in a helicopter hovering overhead, I mean, I could still be able to look down on forces. The forces from, let me get this right, so the forces, so like all these forces here, for example. Hovering overhead, I would be able to see individual soldiers, probably, given, you know, visibility and stuff, light, illumination and so forth. But basically, at this scale, you know, a commander could see these units from the proper position. So in that sense, figures are appropriate. But at the same time, this doesn't represent just three figures. Obviously, it represents a platoon, and that, you know, and covered by the NATO symbology. But the point is that the NATO symbology represents a formation, not just a unit type, not just a unit type. So if I'm playing a game where it's man-to-man combat, obviously I don't expect to see a NATO symbol. And even though there are games now at the higher level where divisions, even certain battalions, brigades, but even divisions are represented by figures, which is, it's not wrong at all. It is acceptable, but it's not, I mean, I would rather have the unit symbol shown. Because that's what, I mean, I'm never going to see that division. Never going to see that division in operation. Period. So what I'm going to see is that formation represented by a symbol on a map. This is what I'm getting at. So, so if I would typically see formations as units on a map, then I'm looking for that type of symbology. Whereas if I'm squad leader, platoon leader, or company commander. I'm, looking out over the engagement area. I'm seeing real soldiers, individual soldiers, individual subordinate leaders, individual riflemen, individual machine gunners. And obviously, in that case, your figures make sense. And yeah, that this platoon level, I think it's great that both are used in this case. I just think that's right. Good counters, good size of all the information. I don't mean the size of the counter. If this could all be gotten on a half-inch counter, that's not a half-inch counter. These are larger. But if it could all be gotten on a half-inch counter, which I think would be too crowded, that'd be fine. I just mean the information, each piece of information on the counter is just the right size, placement, etc. So it's funny that such well laid out and designed counters are on such poorly developed maps. Leaders, if you've never played Panzer Grenadier and I told you leaders were represented by individual counters, you might think that there's a maybe a was it a headshot, some leader like I think the Vivictus games tend to have, or you might think that there's a single soldier silhouette, maybe, but no, this Panzer Grenadier goes with fairly, I think these are supposed to be fairly historically accurate officer rank devices and I don't know what else to say about that, but so here's a German lieutenant with the combat value and morale value. I'm sorry, the leader's morale in the middle. The obviously I'm not playing enough. Obviously not playing often enough. The leader's morale is a large number in the center. Combat modifier on the lower left, morale modifier on the lower right. So this German lieutenant has an individual morale of 10, combat modifier of 2, morale modifier of 1. This Soviet lieutenant is pretty darn mediocre. This is, I like the use. This is pretty evocative of the history, which I guess was also kind of my point. Not an abstract game, so be evocative of the history in some way. And there's certainly different ways of doing that. So these are the fourth edition rules, downloaded. And it's interesting. I thought that I was perfectly happy with the third edition rules. I thought I had adjusted well enough to the third edition rules, and I initially thought I had no reason to switch over to the fourth edition rules, but actually, after I downloaded them and started reading them, I was pleasantly surprised that actually, for whatever reason, and I guess the fourth edition rules were also rewritten and they were edited for clarity, I believe, pretty sure. And wow, they succeeded. Fourth edition rules are easier to use, easier to grasp than third edition rules. So it's the fourth edition rules to play with. So that is Panzer Grenadier. Some comments on the graphics. Definitely be coming back to this game regularly, actually, this series regularly, actually, I think. And I'm thinking, after even just dealing with the game, I would like to, give some attention to these many, many, many scenarios that are in the series. Look at some scenarios. Give some. Take some closer looks at the scenarios, in different ways, both as history and as, games. This is another Avalanche Press production. This is War of the States. This is Gettysburg, 1863. A interesting system. In a very in a superficial way, I actually thought it, actually, when I originally got it, I assumed it was a lot like the Eylau game that I had from, I think, USA Games. But actually, this plays different. What I have played is Rome at War. Actually, I'd like to get that one out again soon. Yeah, Rome at War. And this one does play differently than Rome at War, as you would expect that it would. Inside this box is not just Gettysburg. I also have another game in the series, the Chickamauga Chattanooga title. So first, if you're not familiar, this game has some things not used that often, too often. It has oblong, rectangular unit counters. Take a closer look at those. And it has area maps. Yes, this is Chickamauga. I played this one, Chickamauga. Chickamauga and Chattanooga, War of the States scenarios. Series rules. War, they call it War of the States, War of the Empires. But I only played Chickamauga here, and I don't think I have anything from. I don't know if I have anything from War of the Empires or not. Not sure about that, actually. Very, very simple terrain effects chart. There are some modifiers by percentages here to reduce attackers' dice by 25%. Some other percentage modifiers. So this counter sheets. So okay, well. This game uses multiple counters and sides of the counter to represent multiple steps for these large units. So we're talking First Division. Yeah, this is Gettysburg. So Wadsworth. Wadsworth is. Okay, Wadsworth is the division commander. So Wadsworth, in command of the 1st Division, 1st Corps. So this oblong represents Wadsworth Division at strength level A, the strongest. So Wadsworth will go from A, it takes a hit, it flips over to B, and so now it's at B with reduced values. When it takes a hit, this one's coming off the board, and you're going to pull out this next counter at level C, and so forth. And these, and there's E, and these can go all the way down to, yep, that's all the way down to F. So in this game, you can have fairly high level of steps represented by, you know, in this case we're talking six steps represented by three counters. Similarly, the cavalry are square counters but use the same concept of reducing number of steps indicated by size of a counter. You have your artillery counters as well on square counters, and you got your leaders there. Confederates. Gettysburg. Chattanooga's map. So these are very, they're actually nice to look at maps. You do have to look closely for the hash marks indicating high ground. I guess those could have been darker, and the lines, these are bold black area boundaries. Those ones could have clearly been less distinct. It could have even been they could have been see-through, whatever the technical term for that is. And I also remember playing, when I played Chickamauga, I remember that I thought there was a pretty clear map error. There's an area on here that looks like it is misdrawn, and I don't recall ever, you know, seeing this issue identified by anybody else. I think I checked on Consum World. Unless, of course, you know, I was wrong and it wasn't misdrawn at all. That'll probably come out when I play this again and record it. But the thing is, when the units are on the map, it plays quite it plays well. The bottom line, this is in no way a review. I don't do reviews. This is not a review. It's just commentary. This is one of those games where, when I read the rules, I thought to myself, first I thought, there's no way this is going to be very interesting. I thought it was way too, not even simplistic, but too scaled out. to be of any interest. And that turned out to not actually be true. He was actually interesting enough. Now, it was interesting enough because over, as I recall now, this is about a year ago, so I'm recalling, I think it was interesting enough where you, as either the Union or Confederate commander, you might be trying to, you know, turn the enemy line, turn the enemy flank. And this happens over several turns. And I think, I guess, the action passes at a rate that is actually interesting enough. Maybe it has to do with the fact that the units do have so many steps. Perhaps that's it. But I did find the action engaging enough. The biggest thing is that when these unit counters are on the map, and you can see that these unit counters have these formations drawn with multiple figures. So in these formations, so here you can get a better look. You have clearly, very clearly distinguishable soldiers in formation. These drawings are actually, this is as good as I would expect from a war game. So these drawings are actually very good. Okay, so I'm going to say that, looking at the screen here, these drawings are way better than what I think is being captured by the camera. These are very good, very distinct, and even colorful, detailed line drawings, basically. And so in these, when these formation markers are on the map and you have the battle lines arrayed, it's actually very, very interesting, a lot of fun. You know, you feel like you're seeing your army arrayed across the battlefield like some of the old military history books or atlases that had those hand-drawn battlefield panoramas. That's a better way to put it. When you have the two lines arrayed across the battlefield, these unit counters against these maps creates a very nice, very evocative panoramic view of the action. Like I said, it was just enough decision making. So by that I mean, do you press an attack? Do you try to pull back and shorten your lines? Do you try to race around an enemy flank? Or do you try to refuse your own flank? These large level decisions, so we're talking really, you know, you're the army commander and your orders are going down to division level. It's fun enough. It definitely incorporates some miniatures-esque elements. But I would say, despite the graphics, for example, despite the multiple steps, which I think of as more miniatures-esque than X Encounter, despite that, it's actually very much a X Encounter war game, though of course area maps and oblong counters for infantry. Very important to keep your formations sorted. For this one I just went with separate baggies for each formation. It's fun. It will come out again. It'll be interesting to try a Gettysburg, just because I wonder how this system will, I guess, handle the well-known actions of that battle. Not Pickett's Charge, obviously, but Gettysburg. Just, I think of Gettysburg as being made up of a bunch of really interesting and important, tactical actions. Smaller tactical actions. So it'll be interesting to see and play Gettysburg here, Gettysburg at this scale. So interestingly enough, with this map, I do believe I have the original map, and I don't. There may have been a remake of this map in a significantly different, possibly even period style. But I'm not. I'm okay with this type of hand-drawn look. Yeah, I don't have any problem with this at all. And as you can see on this one, can you see? Yeah. See, this one does not have the heavy black area boundaries. Instead, this is a gray, I guess. But yeah. It'll be fun to try Gettysburg when I get this one out again. So yeah, I guess I got Chickamauga, Chattanooga, Gettysburg. I'll say it's hard to recommend this game. I will not get rid of this, and I will play this. Think I probably have. Actually, it's hard to say. Do I have more fun playing Rome at War? Well, I guess I find both fun in slightly different ways. But it's hard to really recommend this game because. Here's why. The rules are not beginner level, I guess. I definitely had to go online and hunt down every question and answer I could find to make sure I was playing it correctly. So it doesn't seem like this would be good for a beginner, whereas somebody who's much more experienced in war games, more experienced war gamer, might be put off with the idea that this is too simplistic, too almost Euro-esque in the sense of a more experienced wargamer might say that the details of warfare during the Civil War can't possibly be dealt with and represented in these games, which is probably true. But why did I enjoy playing it? I enjoyed playing it because the grand tactics at the highest battle level were addressed and brought out in the rules. And really, for that reason alone, I enjoyed it and I will play it again. There's certainly no detailed formations or fixing bayonets or anything here, but yeah, at the broadest battle level, enough was there to make it a fun experience. I would say it's more fun than anything else. It was fun trying to maneuver the overall, the whole army, maneuver the whole army against the opposing army and smash it at just the right time, just the right place. But it's more about that when it's actually set up. Now for something completely different. This is, yes, it is, Axis and Allies miniatures. This game, I was definitely had some questions about it. I played it quite a bit. And I will play it some more in the future. The reason why I'll play it in the future is that it has just barely enough tactical stuff going on to make it, again, fun. Without being too egregious with its use of history or warfare, nature of warfare. Definitely had some reservations at the outset. Probably just kept going with it because it was readily available and opponents were readily available. And I guess those can be significant significant factors in one getting into a game or not. So this is a booster pack. This is the North Africa series, a number of different series. So this is the North Africa series. Each booster pack will come with a random five miniatures. Not going to say anything about the game yet, but I will I break it out to play it again. Case we have a obviously we have a truck. Obviously a tank. We have a kneeling soldier. a standing advancing soldier. It's actually been a while since I've played, but yeah, they are clearly marked on the bottom. So an M8 75mm pack howitzer. The guy is veteran Fallschirmjäger. Veteran Fallschirmjäger. Let's see how much you can really. Well, yeah, you can see the shorts over the pants. It would focus. So yeah, I can see the clearly see the pants over, or the shorts over the pants, baggy pants. Yeah, clearly see them from behind the uniform. Yeah, actually, does have some detail distinguishing it. Distinguishing it as Fallschirmjäger, and this kneeling guy is a Wehrmacht veteran infantryman. So again, let's see. German grenade weapon. Yeah, enough to distinguish it again. Early M4A1 Sherman rotating turret. Truck is a Opel Blitz 3-ton. It is very small writing, but it's there, which is good for verifying the Mini to its corresponding card in the collection. Alright, so we got the Opel Blitz 3-ton vehicle that we just looked at there. So try to go off of memory here. Four, I believe, is the points purchasing unit to play. Obviously, this unit as a truck has no attacks against infantry or vehicle targets, no attacks at all at any range. Speed of 3, defense of 1 and 1. These are the almost every mini in this game system has one or more special characteristics or unique characteristics. They may not be special. High gear 2, with this unit, makes its entire move along the road, it gets +2 speed. For example, just an example of one of these characteristics. Large transport, this unit has a transport ability, but can carry 2 soldiers, one of which can be artillery. And then a little bit of historical text. One of the more widely produced German trucks, the Opel Blitz, was known for its reliability and efficiency. Nice drawing there. So vehicle unit characteristic card. The tank. Yeah. So the early M4A1 Sherman, United States, drawing. So again, the cost, the year that it can first come into play or is available for purchase, speed of 4, defense of 5 and 4, and there are its attack values. If I remember correctly, those are the number of dice that this unit rolls when attacking the either infantry or vehicle targets at these ranges. These are large hex. The maps are large poster size paper maps with large hexes. So this one has fire hazard. When this unit receives a damage counter, roll a die. On a 5 or higher, destroy it immediately. Yeah, so right there shows you that these special characteristics aren't always good, aren't always positive. Nicknamed Ronsons, after a brand of cigarette lighter, the first Shermans tended to catch fire easily. Trusty Fallschirmjäger, veteran Fallschirmjäger. Fairly expensive. Tax. As a paratrooper characteristic. Close assault 8. Hardened veteran. This unit can move while disrupted and rerolls one attack die during its turn. On 10 May 1940, German forces assaulted Eben-Emal fortress from the air. 85 paratroopers of the 1st Fallschirmjäger Division helped capture the fortress and 1,200 defenders. Wehrmacht veteran infantryman. Half the cost of the veteran Fallschirmjäger. Close assault 7, steely resolve 2, an attack must beat this unit's defense by 2 or more in order to score 2 hits against it. Suppressive fire, this unit can make any number of defensive fire attacks each phase. Each Wehrmacht soldier was encouraged to think 2 grades of command above himself. Thus, if his immediate commander was put out of action, he was capable of assuming the mantle and carrying on to complete the mission. And the M8 75mm pack howitzer, artillery piece. An upgrade to the M1 howitzer. This was a light and mobile artillery piece that saw deployment in every theater where U.S. forces fought. Those are some of the figures, units from Axis and Allies miniatures. I'll be having some fun with this in the not too distant future.